You shouldn't have done that, poor little feller.
Is everybody ready? Yep, everybody's ready. Good morning, everybody. Welcome to the Praxis 55712 channel, and welcome to my upstairs grow room. I have a couple things I wanted to show you as an update and also as a precaution for you to help you with your indoor growing. One of the things that I have going on right here with one of my pepper plants, and as a matter of fact, this is a peppercini or pepperoncini, I don't know. You know what I'm talking about. It's those little pickled peppers that you get at the grocery store. I'm growing a peppercini in a pot because I want to get it nice and sturdy and growing really well for the spring growing season to plant outside. A lot of people will plant their seeds about 6 to 8 weeks before the last frost or whenever they're supposed to plant them outside. I like to plant mine earlier so that they get a little bit bigger. I have the room, I have the light, I have the time. So I like to grow my plants a little bit bigger. That way I'm not planting this little tiny seedling outside and waiting for months for it to get going and to get some fruit. By the time this goes out in the spring, it's probably going to be about this tall and about, hit my microphone, and about this wide. And it's going to be all ready to start producing fruit when I put it outside. So I'm not wasting a precious month or so of my short growing season up here in Minnesota waiting for this thing to grow. I can enjoy it growing inside, and then when I put it outside in the spring, I can start getting flowers and fruit. But one of the things that I have going on with this pepper plant that you may have going on with yours is a condition called pepper leaf oedema. And I'm going to put that word right here because you think it would be spelled E-D-E-M-A, but it's actually not. It's O-E-D-E-M-A. Oedema. And I guess the O is silent. I don't know. But that's how it's pronounced. And I had to research this last year to find out what exactly was going on with my plants. Coffee break. Anyway, pepper leaf oedema is no worries. And it looks like something when you look underneath the leaf, like some kind of weird bug attack. It looks just like a bug attack. And when you see your leaves a little bit crinkly, you might get a little bit worried thinking, oh gosh, I'm overwatering, underwatering, overfertilizing, underfertilizing. I kicked it. The cat kicked it. You know, any possible scenario could be going on. But I want to reassure you, it is no problem at all. Let's get a nice, good close-up look at this so that you can see exactly what pepper leaf oedema looks like, okay? Do you see the little white bumps here? I sure hope you can. My camera really does blow when it comes to close-ups. But there will be little white bumps underneath there, and it looks like crusts of salt. And what that is the cells having a problem with too much fluid going into them, and then they kind of expand and burst, and they have problems, and it can distort your leaves. You'll get leaves that look like this. And it's nothing to worry about. All that means is, from what I understand, your plant is bringing up a lot of moisture really fast. The pores are unable to transpire the moisture out into the humidity because I guess it's just too humid. So what you want to do is let your soil dry out. I know it's really something that I harp on about, but it is the best thing you can do for your plants. So I wanted to show you this because it happens to me as well. And this has happened more than once because I do get tempted to overwater just like you. So don't worry, even though I preach don't water, look at what I do. I wanted to show you this because it happens to all of us. This is not a game ender. It's not going to hurt you. And one last thing about the pepper leaf oedema. I want to make sure that you know all you have to do is water less. Don't be tempted to spray it with anything. I know it looks like it's going through some kind of attack like virus, bacterial, bug, you name it, but it's not. And it's a very harmless thing. If you hit it with neem, if you hit it with pyrethrin, if you hit it with that chili spray, I can almost guarantee you, you got a dead plant on your hand. Because with the issues it's going through with the pores and stuff like that, it is not in the best of condition to be hit with all of these chemicals, whether they're organic or inorganic. So don't do it. Step away from the water and step away from the sprays, okay? Your plant is going to be just fine, I guarantee it. Ha! Take a look at this. Take a look at this. Let me get you in right close, and I wanted to show you what's going on with this little beauty. This is all the new growth from those stems. Remember when I cut it? It looked really sad. It was just these itty-bitty stems, nubs, and it looked like crap. A couple of you have pruned your poinsettias and posted your pictures on my Facebook, and I really do appreciate that because it gives a little bit of confidence to everybody else who wanted to try it and they were a little bit afraid. This is what you can expect. And If you didn't do it this season, next year during the Christmas season, get yourself a poinsettia, and it's better to wait until right after the Christmas holiday or right at Christmas. They're basically giving these things away. And you can get one that looks in poor shape and just prune it all back, and it will grow all kinds of new growth. And by next Christmas, this is going to be a monster plant. And you can just decrease the light and force the red to form on the top, or you can just grow it as a regular houseplant. I am very happy with it. And all of you that are following along and taking your poinsettia and pruning, you should be seeing some new growth. Maybe not as much, maybe some more, but you ought to be seeing some new growth. And what you want to do is give this plant decent amounts of light, because once it starts putting out this new growth, it's going to go bonzo on you. So give it good light. And if you're going to put it into, ow, something bit me, probably another spider. If you're going to be putting it into bright light, move it gradually, okay? You don't want to take your plant from a shady location. Ooh, deadly. You don't want to take it from a shady location to a bright location. Bad thing for your plants. Definitely a shock. Ooh, take a look at this. People have asked about the update on the vanilla, because when I did my whole grow room experience, I tried to get all the plants in, but there are so many and they're just, you know, like this weird puzzle. I forgot. I totally forgot about the vanilla. It's not that I didn't want to show it. It's just I totally forgot to show it. So, ta-da. This is the vanilla. Now, I got this vanilla plant when it, oh, by the way, I should just take you in close and explain it while you're up here. Now, when I got this, it was from here to here. It was just about maybe 5 inches long. And I planted it, it grew over, and it started to go up. So I tied it to this stick, and let me try to pan with a minimum of jerkiness. As it got taller, you can see that the stem got fatter. Yes, it did. And it grows right up this stem, and I don't know if I'm hitting the top. Oh yeah, there's the top. Now as it grows, let me see if I can show this off. The plant will put out aerial roots, and those are mainly for support when it's growing up against a tree or whatever it grows up. I have no idea what these things grow up. This is my first time growing a vanilla, and I don't have anything for them to really latch onto. So what I'm doing, as you can see right here, I tie a piece of string very loosely so that it doesn't strangle the stem, just very loosely to bring it up against here, and there's one down here, one here, and I'm going to put one up here about maybe every 6 inches to hold it up against the bamboo, and that's basically all I do. And one other thing that is kind of strange, this, the thing that's holding my microphone, by the way, I put my microphone in my plant because when I clipped it onto me, I had the, you know, the transmitter behind me, and every time I moved, I would get this weird interference, and I lost a lot of footage on my last video. I feel like a talk show host. I lost a lot of footage on my last video because it was getting a lot of weird interference with that stupid foil on my grow room, and I got to take that out of here. It really bounces the signal, and I don't like it. So yeah, my plant's holding my microphone for me. But my microphone is not the topic. What is the topic is this. This is remarkable, and it's a first for me. It's a very first. This is okra, cowhorn okra. And Shane from the Gardener 3434 channel is giving away, or was giving away, okra seeds. And I got one, and I planted it, and this is my okra plant. I planted this in, I think it was late October. And it has a flower up here, and I've showed the flower on my Facebook, but I pollinate the flowers, and I got a little okra thing. Take a look at what I have growing here. So here's the first okra. I pollinated another flower, and it's right there. I mean, it fell off, and so, yeah, we have a little okra baby. And take a look at this. This is an okra flower. Yeah. So I really didn't know how to pollinate this, and they are beautiful, aren't they? So what I did was I reached my finger in here, and I noticed that on the sides I got pollen. So I would just reach my finger in here, and then I noticed when I touched the top here, the pollen would fall off. I really don't know the makeup of an okra flower, so this is what I do. I touch the sides, then I touch the top. I just assume that's what a bumblebee does. And that's all I do. The flowers don't last very long at all. They last about a day, and or less than a day, and then they close back up and fall off in a few days, and then you get your little okra thingy. I guess that's how it works. Yes, I'm just that scientific, and there are quite a few others right here coming out. It really starts growing wild and nutty. I don't do anything special with the growing conditions except give it bright artificial. Ta-da! Yes, Ray's growing okra inside. I don't know what's going to happen next. Maybe corn? I don't know. But I'm very happy about this, and I pollinate the flowers like I just showed you, and it seems to work. I don't know how to pollinate okra flowers. I've never really studied the flower, but apparently what I'm doing is right. I assume that insects, you know, they just come around and stumble around and roll around in your flowers and get drunk on the pollen. There is no scientific method to what they're doing. They're basically just bumbling around in there. So I figure my finger can screw up everything just as well as an insect. So I just put my finger into the flowers of all my plants, peppers, okra, everything. With tomato flowers, generally they're self-pollinating and they have the male and female parts all enclosed in that yellow cone. So all you gotta do is tickle them, which taps the flower and causes the pollen to fall inside the whole thing. It's all enclosed. Falls from inside, from one part to the other part. Problem solved. And that's probably why I don't have too awful many problems with cross-pollination. Some tomato flowers can cross-pollinate, some can't. I really don't worry about it. I just plant them 6 feet apart and I've never had an issue. So that's my scientific method to growing tomatoes. Now you know my secret. Okay. I love this thing. This, I don't really have room for it over here. Really sorry. But I'm going to probably zoom you in like I always do. This. Don't fall. This is my banana. Yeah, it's called a blood banana or a zebrina banana. And I got this as this little teeny tiny life plant online on eBay. And it was a beauty. It was just this itty bitty thing and it had a couple chopped leaves. Actually, it wasn't a beauty. Let's just be honest. It was an ugly, ugly little duckling. And I planted it and I put it in a little tiny pot like this size and it grew. It grew really fast and I thought, oh crap, what am I going to do? So I put it into a big pot and it grew some more. These things grow phenomenally well. And I did have an issue though. Spider mites, my nemesis. Spider mites hit everything in here and they didn't spare the banana plant. And so what I did was I sprayed as much as I could and I removed leaves as much as I could because yeah, you can spray all of the leaves, but for me it's a lot easier to just take off the worst affected leaves, get them outside and throw them far, far away. And then the ones that I need to save, I'll spray those. I sprayed this and removed all of the lower leaves. I had a bunch of lower leaves down here. Removed them and it survived beautifully. It is just remarkable. It is a very tough plant, a beautiful plant, fast growing plant. I have nothing bad to say about this thing. I would definitely recommend a banana plant. And I believe this may be a dwarf. I'm not really quite sure. I know nothing about banana plants. If you took everything I knew about banana plants, you could fit it into this big zero right here and still have room because all I know is I put it underneath the light. I water it well, let the soil dry out just a little bit, but not bone dry because it's tropical and it probably doesn't really much appreciate that. So I let it pretty much dry out and then I give it more water. That's all I do. Yeah, really scientific. I know I wish I had more expert advice for you, but I do. Thanks everybody for joining me in the upstairs grow room for a little bit of an update and a little bit of a precautionary tale for a condition that you may have going on with your plants. I gotta get going. Thanks, everybody, for joining me in the grow room. This is Ray's Praxis 55712 channel. Have a great day, everybody. Bye. We are done.